She's obviously from Germany, no doubt about that. Well, the Norwegians think the Norwegians are going to win. The French think Martin Fourcade's going to win. Well, nice to have someone who's actually thinking with their head rather than their heart, which is unusual. Well, I'm not sure you're going to learn too much from that. You did hear some of the biggest names, of course. Chapulin, who starts number one. Martin Fourcade, who's decided an early start is good. He went for group number one as well. The Norwegians, I'm absolutely staggered they've gone late when you see how hot it is out there. And the tracks are going to get cut up, beaten up as this race goes on. But they've stuck to their guns, they've been confident, they've put all their eggs in one basket, the Norwegians. And so we'll see whether it's better to go early or late. There's the Grand Master, Ole-Einar Bjørndalen. Can he do what he did at the beginning of last season and win an individual? He'll have to take the scalp of Johannes Tingesbo. Interesting to see how he's getting on. Julian Eberhardt, fast enough to win, but will he hit enough targets? Generally, Mike, 19 out of 20 is all you have to do. Actually, you can go back 10 years before you find the first person who cleared all the targets to win the race. 19 out of 20 generally seems to be good enough.
It's quite surprising. We might see something different today. Could Fourcade mess up and miss say two? I think that's the only opportunity for the rest of the best to take this title today. He's just been so dominant the last four majors. He's taken the championship races, that's including the Olympics.
Air temperature at 9°C and rising as the sun blazes down on the stadium. It is a stunning setting and we've been spoilt for sunshine. It's going to be a little difficult to go back to the Scottish weather for the rest of the winter. Mike, the course here again, you know, it's obviously longer, the individual over 20K, so five times round the 4 kilometer loop, and the climbs are pretty much the same.
Now, when you think of winter sports, we normally expect sub-zero, but 15 degrees, the sun blazing on these athletes over this very challenging 4 kilometer track. Total climb, I think it says 740 meters from start to finish. Huge amount of effort.
Well, one or two athletes, I think, are likely to be racing in T-shirts this afternoon. I haven't seen anyone in shorts as yet. Not always a good idea. Let's have a look at the start sheet. Chapulin deciding he wants to get this over and done with. He drew bib one. Fourcade goes number four, followed by perhaps Austria's favourite today, Dominik Landertinger, a local man, going number five. Rastoguyev's Mike 14. He's actually had a couple of good individuals this year, and he's skiing well, so he might be a man to watch out for. Erik Lesser, number 27.
Erik Lesser definitely showed that at the Olympics he can do it. Scotty Dixon there at 28, a little bit nervous pre-race, as you'd expect.
Well, I hope he's put bib number 29 on, because that's where he's starting, so...
did I say 28? I'm thinking the zero to lane 29. What about, just saw, of course, Loginov, bib 31. I think he's got to be one of the favourites today.
Yeah, Shemp's in the 40s. Alex Gleave, this is his first big race, starting number 52 for Great Britain. He's a little nervous. He's not feeling particularly fresh as he's just come from the British Championships, which we'll talk about later on. Garanichev goes 73. He's pretty much on his own. He's got Pfeiffer at 77. Well, there you see the Conditions at 9 degrees, 33% humidity. I certainly noticed last night, Mike, actually the last couple of nights, it's been very dry.
It's incredible. Earlier this morning, it was 23% humidity, and the coaches, the wax technicians, have never heard of that kind of dryness here at this time of year. The course profile, you can see it going around there. We'll see the profile in a minute. 4 kilometres times five. 9 degrees at the moment, but due to rise a lot more to 15 degrees.
Now, we usually come here in December. The conditions are so different, it's unbelievable. I think Hochfilzen will be applying to host the World Cups in February and March in the future, because everyone's enjoyed it. We generally get good crowds here, there's no doubt about that, but the atmosphere is better, the numbers are bigger. Certainly, we've got far more spectators out on the course. And you know, that's what it's all about. If you can't get fans, you haven't got an event.
It's great. And what about the weather? Since the first race, this... 8 days ago, last week on this day, it's been blue skies, sunny, ideal for the spectators.
Yeah, I was just thinking while we were out skiing this morning, in my lifetime, I can think of about 5 days where you've been able to ski everywhere. You don't need the tracks, you can ski everywhere. We've had six consecutive days of skiing off-piste wherever we've wanted.
It's incredible, and that's because the sun on the snow in the afternoons, it's so hot, then minus 10 in the evenings, it's a crusty, beautiful surface. Wonderful free skiing.
Yeah, and actually quite a few people out 7-8 o'clock in the evening skiing under the full moon, the snow moon as it's known in February. It's a stunning setting, and that's part of the reason that the atmosphere is so good. But now everyone focused on the race, and it's Anton Chapulin who will be attracting all the attention over the next couple of minutes. So will he have been happy to draw bib number one? Probably not, but once he's 30 seconds, 40 seconds into the race, I don't think it will faze someone of his experience. Anton Chapulin looking to win his second individual race in succession, having taken the victory in Antols, hitting 19 out of 20. It was that second prone that caught him out, but he was still quick enough to beat Fourcade on that occasion. 21st in the sprint, he worked his way all the way up into fourth position in the pursuit. That was a tremendous comeback.
That was a wonderful comeback, and if only he had another, 500 metres, he may well have moved up onto the podium. I think you're right about him maybe not being so happy about bib number one. There were only 17 in group one.
102 starters all together. There are lots of big names in group one. They certainly get the advantage on their first lap and probably on their second. By the time they go around for the third time, the tracks will be well skied in. So Chapulin is away, looking to improve on that fourth place in the pursuit. If he shoots the same as he did in the pursuit, he's highly likely to be on the podium. He's skiing well. The Russians have been short of success. Astonished to see Russia didn't get a single medal in the World Championships in Oslo last year. So they've got to prove themselves over the next couple of days.
Has been lean times. I must say, Clement Bauer has raised his game here at these championships. A great, not so good sprint, but he moved a long, long way up the field in the pursuit competition.
At 31, Bauer at the back end of his prime, but he's still a fabulously fast skier. Just has to control the shooting. Here comes Lars Hegler Birkeland, and no Tarje Bø this time. I don't think we're surprised to see Bø not racing on the individual, Mike. It was a surprise to see him in the sprint when you consider how bad a season he's had. But Birkeland sitting sixth in the individual standings.
Yeah, Birkeland, he's got the ability to hit the targets. 19 out of 20 he hit in Antholz at... looking at another athlete. Yes, 19 out of 20, came 13th position. If he gets all 20 today, could be the podium.
And here is someone who's expected to be on the podium, Martin Fourcade, the number one in the world. He's only got to finish 15th in the remaining races for this season, and he's going to take his sixth Crystal Globe. That's almost certainly going to go, and he'll equal Bjørn Dalen's record. He's got 10 wins at World Championships. If he gets one today, he moves on to 11, equal with Ole Einar Bjørn Dalen. 11 wins, Mike, this season. He's had 16 out of 17 on the podium. That is phenomenal.
He is just the real deal. He has no weakness. The skiing, there's no weakness in that aspect. And generally, he's hitting 18, 19 out of 20. Landetinger will feel the pressure. He took the silver medal last year in this race at the World Championships. He hasn't been shooting that well lately, and that's got to be worrying. Talking to the Austrian coaches, they're saying, well, it hasn't gone well yet for us. We're hoping today it will.
And when you see the facilities, it's surprising. And I think there'll be one or two questions asked. We may see a few changes in the staff in the Austrian team if they don't come away with some medals. They're running out of time. We run all the way through to Sunday. We've got the men's individual today, the women's relay tomorrow, the men's relay on Saturday, and then the two mass starts on Sunday.
Let's have a look at this hill, Patrick. Yes, they've already scraped the top layer of snow because it was so mushy. But as this goes on, it
look at the indentation from those right skis of Shapoulin. You can see that he's sunk, what, two and a half inches. That is only going to get worse.
Big time. I think it's sensible going in the early part of this race.
Jesper Nelin, 24-year-old from Östersund. Now, for some reason, the first standing chute is the one that gives him problems. Actually, Martin Fourcade, if you look at all the misses he's had, the first standing chute again has been problematic. Well, he's sliced off the bottom of his ski suit, trying to keep the body temperature down. Not a bad move. Actually, we had a chat with Amanda Lightfoot, who said she was cooking during the race.
Absolutely. When you're dressed for expecting colder temperatures and you're just frying these Lycra suits, I'm sure I'd be chopping the arms off or even going in a T-shirt today.
Lars Birkeland through 1.2, 6.3 behind Shapoulin's time. What about Martin Fourcade? We'll get some idea of how the skis are gliding. They should be getting used to these conditions, Mike.
Very much. I do like the way this race, it's more about pacing. It's 20 kilometres, just under half a marathon. And without a doubt, you need to just hold back a little in the first lap, the second lap. Save something for the end of the race.
Yeah, Fourcade certainly has the confidence to do that. 1 second down on Anton Shapoulin. He won't be too fussed by that marker, and he'll get all the information he needs.
Julian Robert just giving him that information now.
Landertinger looks as though he's given away a few seconds to Martin Fourcade. Bauer's time of 2:29, more realistic. He's not going to match Shapoulin's 2:25.
I suppose I'm thinking association here of success. Last year in this race, Landy, he didn't miss a shot. 0-0-0-0, finished second. And I think it was only 8 seconds behind Martin Fourcade. He's got to carry those positive thoughts today.
Yeah, Simonader, of course, getting on the podium as well. So the Austrians getting two in the individual in Oslo.
That track is breaking up so quickly.
I always remember Oslo as Norway's sort of championships. But actually, the French ended up on top in terms of medals. 6 gold to France last year, 4 to Norway, 1 to Germany. The current standing here in Hochfilzen, 4 to Germany, 1 to France, 1, of course, to the Czech Republic through Gabriela Kukalova.
Look at Shapoulin. He's getting the advantage already at the start of this race. Just gone 2:30 in the afternoon of the shade there along the advertising boards. And as the race goes on, that shade will come further onto the track.
And actually, the shade extending a bit further because we've got far more spectators on that particular section of the course. Interesting to see him cutting across here. There may be one or two who decide to stay right as long as possible just to get that extra glide. But he's got some clean tracks, which is an advantage at this stage.
It definitely is. This will break up deeper and deeper and deeper. For the heavier athletes, that really becomes an issue. With what, 50 minutes racing, maybe 51 today.
Clement Bauer. Now that looks as though he's in driving up a hill in with a car in fifth gear. Could come down to doing the skate one, I would have thought.
Strong guy though, isn't he, Clement Bauer? And his confidence certainly higher than it has been than from the previous part of the season.
See how short the arm action is. He'll have to break. There he does. He switches gear with an extra 20 metres to go or so. What's your feeling on that, Mike? Change gears early, keep the tempo high?
I think change gears earlier. You're building a lot of lactic. It's like pushing heavy weights in the gym there. You just feel a little bit loaded from that, but it was efficient. He seemed to be okay with that technique. Well, it'll be interesting to see if he'll do that on his fifth time up this climb.
Martin Fourcade, 1 second behind Shapoulin at 1.2. What about 2.5? 6:37.6 We've had Chapuelin go through 2.9, so we'll get a readout there as well. And suddenly the positions are reversed with the first big climb completed. And that is where Fourcade has been so good over the last 5 years. The steeper the climb, the bigger his advantage. 15 is Sergei Semenov. Now, third in Antolz, hitting 19 out of 20. I think it was the very last shot he missed and threw away his opportunity of getting the win there. But once you got on the podium in an individual and you come to the World Championships and you say, well, there are less people, there are less Norwegians, less Germans, less French, your chances are even better.
Oh, definitely. And Semenov, his ski speed is excellent. 41st in the sprint, he moved all the way up to 15th in the pursuit, only missing one target.
Landertinger from 5.4 behind to 10.6. It's not a fast start, but he does know these tracks better than most, Mike, and he'll know how to pace this. It's a long, long way, five times around the 4K.
But for me, he hasn't looked sparky. Last year in this race, you could see and feel the form, the determination. I think he'll lose about a minute and a half to this man over the 20.
Fourcade already closing in on Birkeland, now 7 seconds clear in the space of, what, 150, well, slightly more than 150 metres, 2.6 to 2.9, so 300 metres. He's taken another chunk of time off Chapuelin. That is phenomenal.
Well, already Chapuelin coming in for his first shoot. It's prone, first time in, then stand after the next 4 kilometres, then prone, then stand. The flags, Patrick, without a doubt, the second half of the zeroing, the flags had all died off. The first part of the zeroing, it was windy like this. Chapuelin was in the first part of the zeroing. Two sections of 25 minutes to center your rifles.
Again, it's the middle of the range where the wind is worst. Chapuelin right up in lane number two. That's a full minute added, not the best start. And Chapuelin's chances looking very, very slim. No one's won this title. Well, there's only one man in the last 10 major championships who's won, missing more than one. And that, of course, Uliana Bjørndalen missed three and still went on to win. I think that was 2009.
I think you're right. Can you imagine after 11 minutes of racing, he's got 2 minutes added onto his time. There's a huge deflation, psychologically flat feeling after that first shoot.
Well, spirits will not be high in the Russian camp, and now they're relying on, I think, Alexander Loganov's their best chance. He starts number 31.
Oh, Clement Bauer, what a pity. That is a poor start. The wind is quite strong,
yeah,
though.
The wind's picked up. The wind's picked up, and those early starters have not picked up on it. Now, is this going to be a test for Martin Fourcade, who's coming in just behind Birkeland, having started a full 30 seconds behind the Norwegian?
Unbelievable.
Good long look down the range from Fourcade. He won't have had any information. The coaches won't have had time to get information out onto the tracks. The flags in the background are moving more than they have done at any stage of the day so far. And you can see the telltales giving away exactly what is going on. No change of the sights from Fourcade. Most people missing to the right.
Well, worst possible start.
If there's one man who can miss two and still think he can win, it's Martin Fourcade. A little bit lucky with shot number five. It was very, very low right, but that first shot way left. Any explanation?
I don't know. He didn't rush it. He took a long, long time settling. He may well have snatched the rifle as he pulled the trigger back. Birkeland managed to get all five.
Only one of the first four clear. That's Lars Birkeland, 30 seconds slower than Fourcade, but he's come out with a 34-second lead, having hit all five. Two misses from Chapuelin, Bauer missing three.
I think this is bad news for the Austrians' favourite. He's 18 seconds slower than Fourcade into the range.
A little bit lucky with two. He might have heard the difference in the shot, split round on three as well. Four is good, five needs to go down, it does. Great start from the Austrian.
Well, Gus Viner, there he is, just marking the shots. I think he'll suggest to his coaches on the track, two left, two up, to be safer next time, if the wind's the same.
And will he do that for the athletes who have yet to shoot?
I think he'll tell the guys in the warm-up pen, the coaches there, just be aware his shots were falling more to the right.
Fionn Maillet looking to become the third person to go clear. It's not going to happen. 82 and 78% his hit record so far this season. shot 0-0-1-2 in Antholz. He's missed one on the first shoot and matched his teammate Martin Fourcade, who is down in third place from the six that have been through shoot number one. At least the Austrians have something to shout about at the moment, and delighted with Landertinger's first shoot, but he's going to have to up the pace. I'm just hoping, Mike, for his sake, that he was pacing that first loop steady, going at, what, 85%, and then we'll push it up later on.
I would hope so, but it's quite a margin, just under 18 seconds over just the first 4 kilometres. And often you fade off in this race. If you have a poor start, you're not really going to pick that up later.
Now, Fourcade, does he have an option? He's missed on that first shoot. I wonder whether he's going to up the pace. We'll see how quickly he pulls away from Birkeland. That will give us an indication.
Birkeland trying to stay with him there. Can anybody stay with Martin today? Especially missing one early on. Missed his first shot.
Lots of soft snow out there. The corners still holding up at the moment. Early days in the men's individual. Those who started early have been through 5.2. And Martin Fourcade, 28.5 behind the race leader. Birkeland it is, having been 34 behind him. So he's made a 6 second gain already on loop two.
Yeah, what interested me there, Patrick, on the descent, Birkeland was about 10 meters behind him and it wasn't drafting. So without a doubt, the Norwegian ski's excellent. I question Martin's skis.
Well, we were questioning the French skis yesterday in the women's individual. They had a disappointing day, having done pretty well in the sprint and the pursuit. So lots of discussions going on as to who's going to win the women's relay. I think your safe bet is probably Germany. But there are quite a few teams who have a chance, Mike. Italy, the Czech Republic, and then, you know, Norway, Russia, Ukraine have got a great history in the relays.
And I think every relay we're watching, women's relay this season, has been wonderful. Wonderful shooting from Benny Vega.
Nice start from Vega. His time at the 2.9 was 11.7 outside.
And I'll have to say, his lookalike, Michael Roesch, I know he's very, very popular as a huge fan club. Unfortunately, he's missed two first time in. Worst possible start.
Yeah, that's a shame. But Mickey Roesch's his trademark this year has been making ground in the pursuit, but generally he makes life difficult by doing so badly in the sprint, and that's pretty much what happened.
Yeah, very good pursuit racer. Loganov about to get underway.
Loganov, we saw him in the mixed relay. He sat out the sprint. Still not sure whether that was because of all the tension between France and Russia in the early stages of these championships.
I really think, Patrick, for me, yes, he's the current European champion. He what, took gold, 3 gold medals at the European Championships. Loganov, rested and ready for this race.
Well, I think he's the only athlete to have left the stadium with one or two of the spectators booing. That's all about the ban that he has just served. And the athlete's desperate for biathlon to have a clean reputation. There are always going to be one or two rogue athletes, but, you know, they don't want institutionalized doping going on, and I think the battle against doping has got to be led by the athletes, and particularly those at the top.
I think so. They've got a voice, a platform to speak from, and Martin did use that on the first day of racing here.
Now Semenov, he can do well in the individuals.
His ski speed is good. He's only 14 off Martin Fourcade.
If he goes clear, he's going to end up 16 ahead of Fourcade, but it's Dominic Landertinger who still leads on 9.17. Semenov could well get inside that. I think he will by a couple of seconds. 4.2 is advantage, and a good start for the Ukrainian.
Birkeland not right in behind him, that's Clement Bauer, but Birkeland is, in relation to his first lap, he's managing to stay quite nicely with Martin Fourcade.
Still leading by 25.1. We won't read too much into that at this stage. But, Mike, on the start sheet, I've highlighted all the big names, and we've got a a mass of them at the start. What, some 7-8 athletes in the first 15 who've got a chance of medaling here. One or two in the middle of the field, the likes of Loganoff we've seen going 31, Destieux for France going 40, Simon-Schempp 46, and then another concentration of top stars at the back end of the field, particularly the Norwegians.
I still find it surprising. I know the theory of going last, but I like what Martin Fourcade has done, gone first. For me, that's the conditions are at their best at that point all round. A more solid track, and you can still ski in the shade there, as Landy's showing us.
Good strength from Landertinger. Incidentally, just to give you an idea of who's racing for who, Fourcade we know going for France, Phil Maillet, Beatrix Destieux and Claude, the five racing for France. They have five because Fourcade is the world champion. Germany with Lesser, Schempp, Doll and Pfeiffer. Now, Mike, they've got 27, 46, 58, 77. They're well spread.
They're well spread, and we've only got... Well, Eric Lesser with that early-ish bib at 27, and we know that he can hit 20 out of 20, fairly regular.
And the Norwegians, Birkeland's got an early start, then Svensson, Oleana Bjørndal, and Johannes Tingesbo, 81, 95, 96.
Incredible. The favourites, the Norwegian favourites, without a doubt. It's very surprising.
And the Russians, a little bit like the Germans, Shapulin going 1, Loganov 31, Granichev 73, and Volkov number 99. Italy on the podium in the women's race yesterday with Rungaldier shooting the perfect score. Paul Malini's already thrown away his chance of doing that, and he looked to have broken his position very, very rapidly. 5 out of 5 to get Shapulin back on. Corsi's done it. That's much better. Now, he may not challenge for a podium, but he's going to feel a whole lot better than he did 11 minutes ago when he came through for the first shoot.
Shapulin, he's got that competitive spirit, makes a big error first time in. I'm just wondering if he'll clear the next 15. Probably will.
Fourcade starting a minute and a half behind Shapulin.
Look at the snow conditions. It's just splashing up every time he places his ski poles in. And the ski is pressing so deep now into the snow. And he's still got 3 laps left. So first time in was prone, second time in at standstill. 1 minute penalty for anything missed. The flags, Patrick, have picked up slightly breeze from the left.
Very surprised with 19 athletes through the first shoot. We've only got 7 with the perfect score. Fourcade looks to be totally focused, and he's going to need to be. Can't afford another mistake. 19-14, that's a good shoot from him. Still skiing faster than anyone else out there, Fourcade. And looking to make it 5 major individual titles in succession. He won in 13, he won the Olympics in 14, he won in Kontiolahti in 15, he won in Oslo in 16, and now trying to make it a victory here in Austria in 2017.
Birkeland, that's why he's been brought into the team, because of the steady, reliable shooting ability. But even with hitting 10 out of 10, he's only got 11 seconds advantage over Martin Fourcade after the second shoot. Bauer has gone and missed 1 in the stand. That's a total of 4 so far for the Slovenian. What I find amazing about Fourcade, you can just see he's barely out of breath. So he's skiing around, that's 8 kilometers already, and he's not flustered. He's always composed, breathing. All the elements are in place.
Maybe that's the effect of the super slow-mo.
I watched his breathing when he came in. Yeah, he was out of breath, clearly, but not over the top.
Now, Landy should get a good response to each hit. What a shame. What a shame. It needed to be clean all the way through if he's going to have a chance of meddling. Quentin Fillmaier makes it 2 misses so far. The shooting record is not good. I think everyone's been a little bit surprised, Mike. We've had fabulous conditions. The light has not been an issue. Is it the wind direction? Is it the fact that the wind generally picking up around 2 o'clock after the zero is finished and building as the day goes on?
I think that is the main factor. The half of the zero was calm, very calm wind. The other half of the zero, two sets of 25, it was actually quite windy. So the coaches should, I would have imagined, pass the information on to the athletes who zeroed in slightly calmer conditions.
Now, if anyone can cope with wind, it should be Eric Lesser. He does a lot of his training in Oberhof, where we went just after the Christmas break, and it's brutally windy there. Great shooting, absolutely fantastic. Best group we've seen so far from Eric Lesser, and that putting a little smile on the face of Mark Kirchner. The German coaches will have enjoyed that.
Well, that's the boldest shoot we've seen so far. Lesser, fearless, straight into action, 5 out of 5, rapid fire.
Simon Schemp pretty much drawn in the middle of the field, number 46 of the 102 starters today, and he gets a massive cheer as he exits the range. As we mentioned yesterday, we're not far from Ruhpolding, which is where Simon Schemp is based. First miss for Chapelin of Belarus, and he misses the second as well.
Östersund, he took third position, first race of the season, well, first individual of the season, and now he's already missed two. He only missed one on that occasion in Östersund.
Now, Mike, last year, Fourcade missed one, still one in a time of 49, so we're looking for a time of sub 50 minutes. It might be a fraction slower with the way the course is cutting up, but two of the three podium places last year shot clear. I think it was one, Morovitz went clear in 2015, with Fourcade and Svensson both missing one on that occasion.
Do you know, looking at the women's race yesterday, the individual, I think we had five perfect shooting scores, and I would expect much the same in the men's race, five, maybe even seven.
Seven last year, 5 and 15, 3 and 14. I think the important thing is that when you miss your first shot, you don't think the race is over. It might be in a sprint, it's not in the individual.
No, you've got to keep so positive in this race. Just saw Scott Dixon shoot the perfect five first time in. That's a good positive start.
Now, can he match what Amanda Lightfoot did yesterday? Getting a PB, just missing out on a top 30, Lightfoot. Good start from Benny Vega. Loganoff on the range, and he's missed the very first shot. And that's a disaster. And number three's gone wide for Alexander Loganoff.
Oh, worst possible scenario, and he's been shooting so well this season before this event.
Wow, flustered.
Well, that's incredible.
What is that about? Because
he only missed one at the European Champs. I think we can say with some certainty Loganov's chances of a podium are now over, missing three.
Only two men have gone clear after two shoots. Rastiguyev, perhaps quick enough to get a podium, missing two. Those two lives have already gone. Bethlich's missing as well. This is extraordinary. What do we got now? 13-14 through the second shoot, only two clear. Birkeland and Vega from Norway and Switzerland. That will certainly get their camps excited as we watch Sergei Semenov look very comfortable in his prone shoot.
Some athletes are just comfortable with this format, the expense of 1 minute in that millisecond you're squeezing the trigger. Semenov, for me, is one of the best at these individual four-shoot competitions. His pulse is on 1-5-1 at the moment.
Very, very comfortable indeed. Shooting, what was that, lane 19, I think, Semenov was on there. The bookies certainly didn't fancy his chances.
Well, he doesn't ski that fast. I think that's why, yes, he's never really up there at top of the list. But if you're getting 20 out of 20 today, you've got a real chance if you ski like Semenov. And for me, the conditions, Patrick, without a doubt, well, he's going all the way left to get the more compact, the more pressed down bit of track. You don't want to be in the middle of the track at the moment.
Well, just looking at those who've got good times going through the split point. Just what is that? Landertinger, who's got an issue?
He's got an issue. Is he taking, is it the transponder, the timing above his boot? I think it is.
Yeah, it might have slipped down into the cuff of the boot, and then it becomes really uncomfortable. So that's a mistake in the preparation from the Austrian squad there. As we cue in on Birkeland. Birkeland, one of the two men to have cleared the first 10. Actually, they've been joined, as we saw, by Semenov. So there are three men clear.
Look at this machine climbing up the hill. I mean, he's so strong. The force through the poles, through the legs, quite phenomenal. And look at the balance. I love every time that explosive power through his legs. He buys himself, what, 3-4 meters of glide time.
Incredible, 129 inside the next best. Dixon sitting in 16th place at the moment. It's a long time since we've seen that name up in the top 30 of a world championship event. Long may it last for Scott Dixon. Shaky start for him in the sprint, missing 4 in the first prone, so a big improvement today.
It's always quite difficult at a championships to turn a bad day around. You know, it's the championships, it's like a magnifying glass. You feel pressure, have you lost the skill? A lot goes on in every athlete's mind.
Mike, going through 2.9, nearly all the top eight times, all except one, come from the top 10 starters. What does that tell you about the first lap?
Well, that's quite incredible. That does tell us that the first part, and you can see here, it's not just the downhill sections, the uphill, when you're having to lift your feet slightly higher up, there's mushy conditions. A lot of energy.
Shapoulin knows that another miss will end his chances of making the podium. Little bit lucky with 5, high right. Well, that's, I guess, one of the problems with going early, Mike, is you don't get the sighters, you don't get any information from the coaches, because I know Birkeland shot clear, but the majority of the first 10 all missed on that first prone.
Very much. We heard in the interview a lot of the fans thought that Benedict Doll could win today. I'm not sure he can. He hit 10 out of 10 on the sprint competition, but he's not really that sound when it comes to 20 shots.
And he's gone out very, very fast, so he might live to regret that come the end of this race. Foucault still looking comfortable. No rush. Usually takes a couple of extra seconds in the preparation of the first shot.
No, he did adjust the sight there. I think he clicked it one, just one. That's 3 millimeters left. The fall of the shot.
Well, you can see his first miss there.
Oh, and maybe too far. Bring
that
it back.
Just below it. Well, that's almost exactly the same as the first shoot, Mike. The first one over to the left, the next one over to the right.
Well, that spiced the race up.
And the last shot was low right. This time it's smack in the middle, so Foucault recovers, but he's down to an 18 maximum score. Still 22.5 inside, but if Birkeland shoots clear, when he comes through his third shoot, Foucault will be pushed down into second place. Well, it's what the script writers want. And in fact, we could do with one more miss from Foucault, because he can still win with two misses. There's no doubt about it. Now, Birkeland, is he on target again? Starting to perspire heavily in the heat, up above 10 degrees now.
Well, Foucault wasn't perspiring at all. Birkeland must have all his winter normal thermals on. Wow, first miss, low right.
I was just about to say, two shots through the same hole, it's looking good, but number three's gone wide. Everything was a fraction low there for Lars Birkeland.
Do you know, Patrick, this range, look at the flags. We see that on every other range at the World Cup, and it doesn't make much difference. But the thing that's happening here is the flags 20 meters from the target are doing exactly the same thing. Normally there's a wind rotation, circular rotation, so they kind of balance out. I think that's what's tripping up so many of the world's best by athletes here.
One theory I had was the large screen placed on the left of the range as we look down towards the targets. You can see it on the screen now. I'm just wondering how that is affecting the flow of the wind. It pushes it up and then the wind has to come back down. So instead of traveling horizontally, there's absolutely a case that in the middle of the range, the wind is coming down from left, high left to low right.
Yes, it is. Maybe that is pressing the shots for those missing low right. But we have seen many missing that top segment, 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock band as well.
Good recovery from Dominic Landertinger, hitting his last five in the prone.
Well, look at the shooting score. That's the same as Shipul and that's the same as Martin Foucault. It's a good day so far for Austria.
Birkeland missing one, still has the best shooting score, but now finds himself 16.4 behind Martin Foucault. Eric Lesser throws one wide, having shot really well and fast in the prone position. Can he make it 9 out of 10? He does. 19.45 on the clock, 18.56 from Semenov, by far and away the best time. So the top three after the first shoot, Semenov ahead of Lesser, Landertinger 3, Vega 4, Birkeland 5, and Wiesner of Switzerland in sixth position. So we've got two Swiss in the top six after shoot number one.
Only four out of the first 27 through the range have hit 10 out of 10. We hardly ever see that in a 20 kilometer. Normally you'd expect about 11, 12 hitting 10 out of 10.
Well, we've only got 18 clear after the first shoot. Kim of Korea has just hit the perfect score, but is a minute off the leading time of Semenov of 9.13. Foucault, he's got, what, 2.5 laps still to go? Or 1.5 laps to go. Wouldn't be happy with that. 21.8 inside. Martin Foucault looking to defend the title he won in Oslo. And still, there are plenty of big names who have yet to get their skis on. Arndt Peiffer is one of them. We've got Dominic Windisch for Italy. Lukas Hofer also for Italy, starting 88 and 90. Bjørn Dalen goes 95. Johannes Tingesbø drawn one behind him. I'm not sure that's a good draw for the Norwegians. So often, Mike, when two athletes from the same country start one after the other, they seem to distract each other.
It's strange, but I totally agree with you. There's an element where you train and you live with each other all the time. It has more influence on you, and you would expect Johannes taking 30 seconds out of Oleina Bjørn Dalen today, therefore catching him up.
Here's Rush, who missed earlier on, and certainly needs to make up for that.
Come on, Rush, and well, he trains with the Swiss team throughout the summer months and winter months.
I think you put me off calling him a lookalike. Of course, it's Benny Vega, it's not...
No, you were right.
Oh, is Rush there?
They're both
well?
In together. They do look very alike.
Benny Vega going through his... shoot, and down go the five targets to make him the first person clear after 15 rounds. So that's an excellent start. Andre Moravitz also going well. So 41.6 inside for Benny Vega. All we've said about him this season is it's not going as well as it should be. But if he can get himself a medal today, let alone the gold medal, we'll turn that around, because that would be an unbelievable result for the Swiss team.
Oh, Benny Vega leading by 41.6. Can he handle the pressure it will build on this next 4 kilometers? Just noticed it. One Scott Dixon has hit the next five, so that's 10 out of 10, one of only 12 now after the first two shoots to achieve that shooting score.
He's learning. Perhaps he had a word with Amanda Lightfoot, psychologist as well.
Yeah, Amanda just missing one out of 20 yesterday. Just seeing Alec Gleaves coming in now as well out the window. His big pressure day, first World Championships race for him.
So Wiesner can't match his teammate, but 9 out of 10 is not bad. And he can certainly get himself a top 20 if he clears the remaining 10. Just looking at Vega's shooting scores in the two individuals this season, Mike, on both of the last shoots, he's missed one. So 4 out of 5. That might still be good enough for a good result.
I think so. Semenov, what has happened there? I'm surprised to see him miss even one today. The wind is slightly kinder right now, so maybe he hasn't adjusted his sights. Sanitra just disappointed there, just radioing out to the support staff round the course. The bad news that Semenov has missed one.
Well, it's great news for Benny Vega. Now, Foucault, 41 seconds behind Vega after that third shoot, Mike. Martin Foucault will be in for his final shoot very soon. Scotty Dixon up in 10th position after two shoots. If he can do the same again, that would be fantastic. And it could be the turning point for British biathlon that has been at its lowest of lows over the last 12 months. So Vega Semenov for Card leading after three. One shoot to go for those athletes. And you can see that Birkeland starting three for Card for Shapoulin, recovering well after those two misses early on. But it's Benny Vega who leads, and the Swiss starting to get excited here in Hochfilzen. All eyes on Samaritz and the Alpine World Championships. But this would certainly ring a few bells on the other side of the country if Vega can medal.
Have to say, Vega, Benny Vega, looking so composed. If he keeps that same mindset, that same composure, he may well be the first to hit 20.
Well, he's going to do better than last year. Finished 49th, missing only three. Now, Benedict Doll took the gold medal in the sprint by 0.7 of a second. And that doesn't matter, does it?
It does not. And, you know, I think it was only the second time in his senior career that he shot the perfect 10 out of 10 in a sprint competition. Oh, he's missed already.
But with so many of the big names missing, Mike, it does not close the door entirely on Benedict Doll. The time, 10.17. He would have been just outside Semenov's time, actually, which is another indication that the tracks are not getting quicker. Now, Shapoulin, can he notch up 18 hits out of 20? He's looking good at the moment. Back to the form we saw from him in Antols. And he'll just be wondering now. I suspect right now he's thinking of those two misses in the prone, saying, why, oh, why? But a lot of that, I'm convinced, is to do the fact that he went first. He had absolutely no information to go on.
I'll tell you what, the strength of mind, the strength of technique there to hold it together, having such a poor start, I think that's a magnificent job.
Well, it won the day for Dalmai yesterday, and that sort of strength, mental strength, won Kukalova her third medal because they both missed on the first shoot.
They did. It's quite amazing. What about Martin? He's obviously skiing a lot faster than Shapoulin. He's in already.
Can you see him missing?
Let me have a look. I think he might miss one.
16 out of 17 races on the podium. He's won 11 so far this season. One more win to equal Bjorn Dahlen's number of victories in world championships in individual races. He makes it 18 out of 20.
Why would I ever doubt him? That man is amazing.
And now you're going to see some fireworks from Foucault because he knows he's got some skiing to do to make up for those two misses. One on the first prone, one on the second prone. 27.8 inside the best at the moment. But that time, I think, will be toppled, especially if Benny Vega can clear the last five shots when he comes round. Simon Ader, fast enough to win. He's certainly fast enough with the rifle, but is he regretting going late? I suspect he's already thinking it's soft out here.
Well, do you know, I've been looking down at the warm-up pen. The athletes are looking up at the big screen, and they cannot but miss how soft and mushy and slow the conditions are now compared to earlier.
That'll be interesting to see if Foucault can match Ader on the first lap. A useful marker for Martin Foucault.
Definitely, and that's what he'll be trying to do, tuck in behind.
Svensson recovered from his antics in the sprint event. He was, I was going to say hypoglycemic. He was a little more than hypoglycemic, wasn't he, at the end of that race, Mike? Total exhaustion.
Yes.
He did some ECG tests yesterday. He did some interval tests yesterday. Everything, he was given the A-OK by the doctors, otherwise he wouldn't be here. But I just wonder whether the 20K is a few K too far.
The Norwegians would never let him start, and it was a blood pressure issue after the sprint competition, and he started so late on that occasion.
Foucault, Shapoulin, Birkeland, the first three through the final shoot. Foucault leading. He's got a margin of 27 seconds over Shapoulin. And Shapoulin knew he had to outshoot Foucault to win here today. He's not managed that. Both men, both favourites, missing two apiece.
Fionn Maillet. That's a real shame. If he'd only missed two, there'd still be a chance for top 10, top five maybe at the end of the day.
Landertinger misses shot number 20, which pushes him on to three misses for the day. Fionn Maillet, three misses also, 154 behind. And Landertinger, 231, down in fifth of the six people through. Clement Bowers had a nightmare, seven misses in all, so nothing for him to celebrate. It's not been a good season for him. What about Eric Lesser? His first prone was fast and accurate.
Well, he's only 58 seconds off the fastest. That's with one penalty more than Sheminov coming in.
Everything looking slightly further left than it actually is, but he's still generally left. That last shot was fine, but maybe a little bit fortunate, but the grouping was okay from Lesser.
Now, a number of athletes saying every time they get off these shooting mats, it's unusual. Normally they're pegged down, nailed down. I noticed Shapoulin struggle. I noticed a number of athletes slipping away when they press on the mat. Normally you get good push off the shooting mat.
Foucault at the moment, where's Simon Ader?
Ader's just gone over past us, so he's skiing much faster than Foucault, as expected, on his first and Foucault's last.
Well, it's another of those days, isn't it, Mike, where Foucault is going to post a time that looks beatable, but even now I'm thinking no one's going to match it. Svensson through his first checkpoint at 1.2, just 0.1 outside, but he's having to go for that dance. He's having to lift those feet that little bit higher. I don't think the snow is actually any slower, Mike, but you have to work harder to generate the speed.
It's quite amazing. Björn Dahlén is the master. Here he is of finding the right path through the track. So it'll be interesting, the line that he takes on this, on each of the bends, on each of the uphill climbs.
What would you pay for that pair of skis?
Oh, huge amount. He's tried 60 pairs in the last 3 weeks coming into this competition just to get the right feeling. They'll be great. We can guarantee they'll be magnificent. And what about, you know, just had a brief chat with Björn Dahlén the other night, and I'm just thinking, when you look at him right now, 43-year-old, how he compares to Martin Foucault, you know, and he took third position in the pursuit. He really is. I'm changing my thinking now. Because his legend is still going on, I think he is unsurpassable in terms of what he can do, still can do. Because remember, he slowed down by about 50 seconds, so at the same age as Foucault, he would be beating him.
But Foucault is starting to pick off Björn Dahlén's records. He already has more individual wins than Björn Dahlén. If Foucault wins today, he equals Björn Dahlén's world championship gold medals from individual races. Now, Benny Vega, this is a huge moment for him. Has he got the nerve?
This is medal-winning stuff. Have you got those five?
He's missed one in both of the individuals on the last shoot this season. He's still got a chance. Still has a chance, but he can't afford to spend much time. 39-46, and actually that miss putting him behind Martin Foucault. So there's the first challenge survived by the Frenchman. And Benny Vega would have come out with a 20 or a 19-second lead, somewhere like that. And I sort of suspect he could have held on to that.
That's quite incredible. Jörn Rorschlager just radioing down the track. He's German, coaching the Swiss team.
The cowbell's ringing out for Benny Vega, who's through shoot number four, and that one miss has pushed him from first all the way down to fourth position. Now he's got to ski himself back up into the top three, because Birkeland just a second ahead of him, having hit 19 out of 20. Still no one clear after four. We've still only got one athlete who's cleared after three, and that of course was Benny Vega. So it is looking good for the Frenchman Martin Foucault. Shapoulin, who was after the second shoot 27 seconds off the pace.
Just looking on the range, there's a problem there for one of the athletes. I think it was Scott, actually. Scott Dixon, the official, taking something to him. Did he lose a magazine? You can request some support. Oh, fast and furious. Sheminov will be so disappointed to miss that second prone.
Well, that is very, very quick from Semenov. He would have had a 50-second lead had he hit all 20. And he'll hear about that very, very shortly. 5.7. He's into second place. And he has a lead of 22 seconds over Anton Shapoulin. So a medal very much possible for Semenov, who's already made the top three in an individual this year. Foucault starting to turn it on in the closing stages. 18.9 completed. 1,100 metres still to go, and there's still a substantial amount of climbing. 24.3. He came out of the range. 27 clear of Shapoulin. So Shapoulin's having a very good final lap.
Well, you could see Shapoulin on his absolute limit. And he needed to be. There's Alex Gleave just coming in. Under the two bridges. Shapoulin coming in for his final 100.
Well, he's put on some good speed over the last 4 kilometers, Anton Shapoulin. This could well be Russia's second medal, but he's got a long, long wait to find out. Started number one, 51 minutes later, the last man will start. Mario Dolder still waiting to go. Uliana Bjørndalen, huge roar from the crowd here in Hogfilsen. He's been coming here for donkey's years. Of course, he raced in the last World Championships here in 2005, Mike. Finished, what, sixth in this event. Roman de Staël, the winner on that occasion.
Yes, I think Bjørndalen missing 6 targets, 6 minutes penalty back then, but he could outski anybody. And of course, he has won this title in Pyeongchang, missing 3 targets, 3 minutes added on.
Johannes Tingisberg. There's no doubt about his potential. He's not quite as consistent as Martin Fourcade, but when he's on form, he's quicker over the snow. But he just doesn't shoot quite as consistently. Here comes Fourcade, 48.51, easily within reach now as he comes round the final bend. 1:50 to go for the Frenchman. Martin Fourcade looking to add to the gold medals. He's already hauled in this World Championships. And he's going to be around 48.30, 48.26.6, so 22.7 inside. And in the end, taking 5 seconds out of Shapoulin, having lost time to Shapoulin earlier.
He is incredible. And he, again, it's that unflustered look. He never looks overly stressed. Yes, he has a break point. We've seen that in Oberhof when he was passed by Schemp and by Lesser in the last 200 metres.
Have you seen him mess up with his finishing routine?
In terms of sprinting?
No, when getting the skis off on the move. I've not seen him make a mistake as yet. The day has to come.
He's always great. That's brilliant from Simon Eder. 9.8 seconds to the first shot released, and he hit all 5.
Another 15 to go. Now, that's good news, but the bad news for those starting late is no one has got within 10 seconds of Martin Fourcade over the first 2.9 kilometres, Mike. If you're giving away time like that, you cannot afford a single miss. Svensson, you can almost say at this stage, he will not win today with that early miss.
Scott Dixon dropped down to 27. That's after the first shoot, but unfortunately, he's missed 2. Whatever that problem was with a magazine, he's missed 2 in his second prone, but still 4 minutes behind. It's pretty good skiing too.
Plenty of people missing targets. Of course, Olympic qualification on the cards today for Scott Dixon. Lars Birkeland in third position. It was a great effort from Birkeland, just that one miss. And that, of course, came in shoot number 3. Still lying in fourth place after the final shoot. Fourcade, Semenov, Shapoulin, the top 3. And Semenov only 5 seconds outside Martin Fourcade's time. Can he match him on the final loop?
Would you like bib number 101 today? I wouldn't. But Eberhard, now the big hope, alongside Eder, for the Austrians.
Yeah. He's got a good power-to-weight ratio, and he's got enormously long legs, so he's not going to have problems lifting the skis over the softer snow. But his style is all about efficiency, and I think he prefers the firm, flat, hard tracks that we've had pretty much all the way through the season. Fionn Maillet. So are we looking at the winning time? 48 28. Dominic Landertinger a long way outside. Three misses. He's only 245 outside. That's one man. Who knows? He could have been on top if he'd shot clear. I suspect there are going to be 20 or so today, Mike, who could win with a clear shoot, but we're not going to see 20 shooting clear.
Well, still only one after the third shoot with that perfect score. Benny Vega, then he did go on to miss one in the final standing.
Now, Andre Morovitz is someone we've got to keep an eye out for because he's gone through the second shoot and he's gone clear. He's 15.3 down on Sheminov, and Morovitz starting number 51. So it won't be too long before he comes in for shoot number three.
Well, Morovitz, 2015, he took the bronze medal, and then at home, he was fourth. I think he shot the... No, he missed two that day, actually, when the World Championships went to the Czech Republic.
Lesser in for his final shoot. Simon Shemp clears. ...13 out of 15 for Shemp. 139 behind. Eric Lesser downing his final five targets, which is going to do him no harm whatsoever. He's on the same sort of schedule as Sheminov, who's 5 seconds down on Martin Fourcade. He's 9.3 behind, so certainly he can expect to move up into the top two when he comes across the finish line.
And Lesser is a very, in terms of stature, short, very powerful skier. He'll float over this wet snow.
Now, the Czech papers have filled their columns with glowing words about Gabi Kukalova. Can one of their men get themselves on the podium and change that?
Oh, that rifle was so steady, he was never, ever going to miss that last shot. Hopefully, he can do that on the very final shot as well.
I think Kuzmar, the 10th athlete to shoot clear after shoot number two. Still Sheminov the fastest of those. Morovitz started 51, remember. He should be in the next 30 to 45 seconds for his third shoot. Trying to match Benny Vega. Still the only man with 15 out of 50.
Well, the officials are trying to scrape some of this wet snow off the top, the deep snow, when they get a chance.
Now, the first World Championships held here back in 1978. Odd Lierhaus, the winner on that occasion, Mike. 1 hour, 5 minutes, 26 seconds. We're expecting a winning time today of around the 39-minute mark. Benny Vega just... the 39-minute mark, the 49-minute mark. 48-28, the fastest at the moment. So Vega into fourth place, and 101. Look how tight that would have been with the perfect shoot, and he knows it.
Well, that would have been quite likely a medal. Look who's relaxed. Job done. Come on, come on, Morovitz. I really believe in Morovitz in this race.
Prone, giving the athletes just as many problems as the stand today. This one's key.
Wonderfully composed, a great start. 1 of 4, only two now to shoot the perfect score after three times in.
But look how tight it's going to be, even with that perfect score. He's only 9 seconds ahead of Vega. What's important is the margin between Morovitz and the race leader at the moment, Martin Fourcade. It's some 50 seconds. 50 seconds with two laps to go. Morovitz is fast enough to hold that, but he has got to outshoot Fourcade on that final shoot.
He absolutely has to. Sheminov going for second place ahead of Shapoulin. I think he might well make it.
48-51, he's got 11 seconds. He's only got 50 metres to go. Sheminov is going into runners-up position. He was 5 seconds down on Fourcade at the start of the last 4K. He's held that to 17.4. Well done to Sheminov. Are the Ukrainians going on the podium for the first time in these championships? Seven nations sharing the medals so far. Germany, of course, with 4 golds. Their chance, is it Lesser? Has he got a chance? He's hit 14 out of 15. Lesser, actually, with 19 out of 20. Well, there you see the standings at the finish. Fourcade, Shaminov, Chapulin. Going back to 1978, Mike, there were a huge number of big names in there. Lierhaus win, Ulrich in second, Rush in third, Ikola four, Krugloff five. Klaus Siebert, sadly no longer with us. Ada was 13, Tikhonov was 17. All the biggest names in biathlon.
Incredible, and Eberhard Rush, his son racing today, and wouldn't Michael Rush have loved to take a medal? His father took a gold, silver and bronze in 78.
And in terms of the British performances that day, Keith Oliver, 24. Of course, Graham Ferguson, 35. Jim Woods in 37th. Were those the golden days of British biathlon?
I think the field the fields were different, and 2 minutes per short missed.
Bjorn Dahlen.
In fact, no, 78 was a small ball.
Bjorn Dahlen, 5 out of 5. Nice way to start. The times, he's given away a lot of time on that first lap.
Quite a bit off the pace, and Johannes Tingesbo, his teammate, in already. 14 seconds, that's fine. That's fine for Bjorn Dahlen. He always paces sensibly.
Well, that is not a slow shoot from Johannes Tingis. He means business today. He wants a taste of gold. He's got 2 silvers to his name already from the sprint and the pursuit, outskiing Bjorn Dahlen on the last lap of the pursuit. Norway missing out on the mixed relay. That was a bit of a surprise on the opening day of the championships. Now, where did Bjorn Dahlen's rounds go? How safe was this? Well, generally pretty good. Where did the fourth one go? Was that low right, Mike?
That was low right.
The conditions are starting to change, and it might be just in time for Andrej Morawiec of the Czech Republic, who has gone through 3 shoots and he has 15 targets down. Looking at the positions after the first shoot, Ada leading on 9.06. Johannes Tingesbo started 96, he's in second. Granicev started 73, he's in third. So once again, having thought that a late start would not help.
Look at that, to the first shot, 11.6 seconds. He's brave. He knows this range better than anyone else. He's missed one. Ader. Well, his father's on the range, 6-time Olympian he is, and his dad, Alfred, knows how to knock 20 shots down. So does Simon, but not today.
19 might be good enough for a medal, though, from Ada. 51 behind. In terms of the finish here, the margin separating the top three at the moment is only 22 seconds. Fourcade, Shaminov, Chapulin, Birkeland at 53, and Benny Vega at 101, having missed just one target.
Take away that first shot that Svensson missed, and it's a great ski time. Oh, snatching the last.
Well, I just got the sense he felt he had nothing to lose, Mike, having missed early on. Svensson was shooting like he does in the sprint event. 2 misses now, and he's going to be over 2 minutes behind. Shaminov coming out, and he's yet to reach the halfway stage. 8 kilometers skied so far. Julian Eberhardt misses shot number one. Worst possible start, just the same as we saw from Landertinger.
That last shot missed by some 1.5 centimeters top right. Massive snatch, nerves, he must be so nervous.
And it's the standing shoot where he has problems. Do you think that's what it is? Is that part of the problem with the Austrian team? Just the home effect?
I think it's partly, but look at the ski time as well. Eberhardt normally always setting the fastest time. It's top two, he's 12 seconds off the pace.
Johannes Tingis, 4.9 off the pace coming out of the range. He's cut that by 0.9 of a second. Simon Ader still leading, but we know that Ader has missed on his first stand shoot, so advantage Norway at the moment.
I noticed Scott was in earlier for his last stand. We put them down, so 0-0-2-0, so good shooting overall today. 18 isn't a bad shot. Just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 athletes at the moment with 1 minute penalty after the 4 shoots.
World Cup points would be an achievement for Scott Dixon. Alex Gleave also racing for Great Britain. He started number 52. We'll try and track his performances as we watch Eric Lesser coming into the stadium. He's looking for a bit of free snow. He is obliged. As number 82, that's Hojdic of Serbia, moves to his left to avoid a collision with Eric Lesser, pushing for the line now. Semenov on 48-46. Semenov's going down into second place. This is a fantastic finish from Eric Lesser. He goes into second, can't match Fourcade, but Semenov now is likely to miss out on the podium. Third at the moment.
Well, look at that time. Lesser has only lost 1 second to the great Martin Fourcade over the last 4 kilometres. That's the ski of his lifetime.
Is that good enough for a medal? Is it good enough for another medal for the Germans, who already have 5? Simon Schemp, another 5 targets, and his time could match Phil Maillet. It should be easily inside Phil Maillet.
Oh, beautiful. That's the way to do it. What a pity for Schemp missing 2 out of 5, the first time in, and then hitting all the next 15 shots down. Ski speed, though, a little wanting. Well, 1:12 behind is still going to be, probably a top 10 at the end of the day.
Just going all the way back to 2.9 kilometres, Mike, before the first shoot. Faster ski times, Fourcade, 6:30. Svensson in second, 3.4 behind, having started 81. And Johannes Tingesbo in third, having started number 96. Oh.
Morovitz looking at that, he's got 2 seconds, he's dropped 2 seconds, I should say. So ski speed, I'm calculating, he's losing about 15 seconds a lap to Fourcade. Morovitz's teammate, Krishmar. So often we've seen him hitting 19, 20 out of 20.
Morovitz needs 5 to win, I'm pretty sure, on his final shoot. Three people clear after the third shoot. Max Davis of Canada has joined Morovitz and Vega, but not skiing at the same speed, but he's still got himself in the top 15. Krishmar makes it 4, 2 of them from the Czech Republic. A much better day. How inspired have they been by Gabriela Kukalova's performances at these championships? 31.1 the margin, and if he can keep that, that will be good enough for a top 5 when he crosses the line, but he's going to keep going up the order if he keeps shooting clear. Schlesinger, 15.8 outside. Late start for Mickey Schlesinger. We haven't seen him in action. Missed out on the sprint, missed out on the pursuit as well. He's really the veteran in the team now, isn't he?
Well, he is. Remember, 10 years ago, the championships in Italy at this time of year, he came third in this event. Poiret won it, Grice second, Schlesinger third.
Now, are we on the verge of another good performance from the Americans? Lyle Bailey, excellent in the pursuit. Susan Dunkley, surprisingly good in the individual yesterday. She was delighted with her finish.
Oh, sixth. You see the reaction there from Leif Norgren. He is gutted to miss that last shot.
Well, that's going to make the difference between top 4 and top 15. He goes into 10th for now. Big moment for Morovitz. This is looking good. It's looking fantastic. Andre Morovitz,
yes!
He could be on his way to gold. Down go all 20 targets. And the Czech Republic, who already have 3 medals, all coming from Gabi Kukalova, are almost certainly going to get one from Morovitz. But what colour will it be? 33.4 seconds to play with over the great Martin Fourcade. And Fourcade was not hanging around on his last loop. 4 kilometres, 33 seconds, Mike. It sounds a lot, but when you see the speed that Fourcade eats up the distance, you know that Morovitz has got to produce the ski of his life.
He really has, and every single one of their coaches will be on that track now. There's still Krishmar out there to come in for his final shoot as well. What a day for the Czech Republic. I had a quick chat with Andre Rybar, the guy who's really created this impetus with the Czech team, and he played down the chances a little of Morovitz and Krishmar. but it's looking great.
Granichev skiing at exactly the same speed as Moravitz, but the two misses pushing him 1:30 behind. Mickey Schlesinger, no problems on the first prone.
His time is good, Patrick, in these, I think, slower conditions. He's well and truly in the race.
Yeah, I think the conditions are just starting to swing in favour of the later starters, but they still have that mush to work their way through. And there's no doubt from the sprint, Mike, that the final lap is really tough when the conditions are like this.
Without a doubt. And what a pity for Schlesinger there. He's missed one. If he keeps the score at one, he's still got a top five chance in this race.
Yeah, podium's out of reach. Only 17 seconds separating the top three at the moment. Johannes Tingesbo, he's one man who can miss one and think of getting on the podium.
Look at his time. It's a good time. If he gets these five down, he'll go out in first place.
Brilliant reflexes. Sensational. Absolutely sensational. Johannes Tingesbo is on fire, and I don't think I've ever seen him so focused in a race. He wants this one badly. Look at Ole-Arne Bjørndalen making mistakes. Johannes Tingesbo is clean, and he's got a 12.4 advantage. So Moravitz has he's got a time to chase, and he's got a time to defend as well. Yeah, where are the tent pegs that usually keep them in place? Now, as we have a look at the leaderboard after two shoots, Johannes Tingesbo there, Mike, losing a second or so coming off the mat. How many times have we seen errors like that or accidents like that lose people races?
It can do. I mean, just the stretch he had to give there, all that force, and it's slipping away from you. He did well to capture that fall. I am just amazed they're not anchored down.
Okay, so next time we see Andre Moravitz, any predictions on the time?
I think he'll still be, I think he's going to have the most inspired 4 kilometres, and I don't think he'll lose more than 9-10 seconds to Foucault over the last four.
Well, he's gone through 17.2, and he's still got a 31-second lead, having come out of the range 33 clear, so he's lost only 2 seconds on that first stage of the last loop, but that is the easiest part of the course. It's the big climb that comes with 2 kilometres to go that could cost him.
That's when the energy will be stripped. Anev, once again, he did so well at the European Champions from Bulgaria. He's having another great day, just missed one out of 15. What do you think? 9 seconds to the first shot. It's going to be fast. Well,
I think taking a little more care after that miss in the first stand. Low right, very, very fortunate with shot number three. It's gone down. Does he capitalise by hitting five? He does. So Simoneda's back in the running for a top three position. Moravitz on 29.16, too fast. He's only 20.9 outside.
Skiing well, he's skiing so well. He's pulled 40 seconds back off Moravitz's ski time.
And Ada into third position. He's 10 clear of Krijsmar. He's 18 clear of Lesser. And he is some 30 seconds clear of Martin Fourcade after that third shoot. Danny Mesetic, last chance for the Austrians. 19 out of 20 will be good.
He's taking a hesitation, he's rebuilding himself. Oh, nice. Well, that's the way to ski.
Yep, lightweight, it's warm enough. Not sure the suit sponsors will be so happy. Now, Johannes Tingesbo, 14.3 to play with at this stage. Ole-Arne Bjørndalen just behind him, feeding off the speed of Johannes Tinges. Now, this will be an interesting contrast in techniques.
Well, it is, isn't it? Johannes is all fight and bullish attacking. Bjørndalen is slightly more floating over the surface. And I just wonder, will Bjørndalen be able to stay with him? I think he'll be determined to stay with Johannes over this next 2 kilometres.
He couldn't manage it in the pursuit. Johannes Tinges overtaking Bjørndalen on the climb that they're about to do now to take the silver medal. Bjørndalen, of course, getting the bronze. What an astonishing achievement that is.
Just looking at some other shooting results. Clement Barwell, this is going back historically, had missed four after the second shoot. Alex Gleave has missed four, unfortunately, after the second shoot. First World Championships is always a little difficult. Nerves come into play.
Simon Shemp, two mistakes early on, just as we have seen from a number of athletes who were expected to do well, but he's held strong in the closing stages, goes into seventh position. But Simon Shemp wants medals. They've been hard to come by. Andre Moravitz started the final lap with 33 seconds. One third of that is gone. He's down to a 22.8 advantage. And this is the climb where Martin Fourcade really turned on the plough. He's got to find something extra here. He needs every single one of the Czech supporters to be running alongside him in this last lap.
I just love the way when his mindset is absolutely sound that Moravitz shoots. It's powerful, it's controlled, and it's fearless. The rifle so light in his hands, you can see as the bullet is fired, the rifle just shoots back, moves back into his shoulder.
Is his run of success coming to an end in the individual races? Martin Fourcade has won the last four majors. He won in 2013, he won in Sochi in 2014, the Olympic Games. He won in Kontiolahti. He won, of course, in Oslo with a time of 49.13. He's way quicker than that today, but Andre Moravitz is the man who's challenging.
Still 21, it's still looking good with 1.1 kilometer left.
I think he's unlikely to throw that away unless he takes a fall. Lau Bailey, so close in the pursuit race, has gone through the halfway stage and he's clean at the moment. But even with 25-second deficit, Mike, he's going to struggle to make the podium.
Look how high he's having to lift his right ski up at this stage in the race. Yes, it's the same for all at this time, but the helpers, the supporters are taking this top layer off. That's actually of some benefit at this stage.
So Moravitz looking for a time sub 48.28. He's going to appear into the stadium very, very shortly. Is that Krizmar coming in for the Czech Republic?
It is. His teammate, I wonder if... Yeah. Well, they won't have told him how Moravitz is doing. All he's aware of is getting 5 out of 5. It's really just 1 out of 1. You have to slow down time, and it's just one shot. That's all you're focusing on, but five times.
39.12 has gone. It's 39.51. that he's interested in beating. Moravitz did it. Krizmar's only one away.
Hesitation. Yes.
And down it goes, but those extra 2 or 3 seconds could cost him a shot at a medal here. Watch the time margins, 20 out of 20. He's not as quick as the men who've gone before him. 45.9, down in fifth position. I think he's going to find it very, very tough to work his way up into the top three. Moravitz, on the other hand, is going into the lead, and he's going to be some 18 seconds clear. Moravitz with a time of 48.10.7. 20 out of 20, the secret to success in the individual race. And if he does win today, he'll be the first man since Raphaël Poiret to shoot a clear shoot and win the individual. And that was way back in 2007.
Can you imagine the team meeting last night? Roman Dostal, the Czech Republic, was the biggest surprise to win this race in 2005 when the World Championships were there. And the Czech Republic guys today are performing out of their skin. It's the best shooting we've seen.
I wouldn't mind betting that Roman just put on the video and said, watch this, guys. This is how it's done. That was back in 2005. Today could belong to Moravitz. Andre Rypar. Absolutely delighted, and so he should be. That's a really powerful finish from Moravitz. Mike, 17.9, what did he lose? 16 seconds to Fourcade on that last loop. I don't think many will match that.
Not at this late stage of the race. Karanashev, well, that's got to be his chances over. He took bronze medal at the Olympics in this event in Sochi.
Well, I think the greatest thing about these championships has been that all the time trial events, the sprints and the individuals, have had the coaches in a quandary as to which group is best to start in, because normally the race is long finished by this stage with all the favourites going in group number one, and very, very clever timing by the officials of the races here. The hottest part of the day is in the middle of the race. You've got to gamble. Is it good to go early? Is it good to go late? That is what has made these championships what they've been.
It's unusual. Normally it's pretty clear cut where you go, and Schlesinger, that's another shot missed, sadly. It's still just 14 shots so far. 2 out of 15. Yes, it has been. It's been a strange World Championships in that respect. Very rarely do we have conditions where is it better to go at the front, is it better at the back? For both, they have good reasons, but I still go along with the French going early.
Well, here's a man who could spoil the Czech party. He's a long way to go, Johannes Tingisbo.
He's got over a minute on Moravitz already.
He's still got 8 kilometers to ski. There's the first miss from Johannes, and there is the minute disappearing in a flash. Bjørn Dalen on the range alongside him. 4 out of 5 keeps Johannes Tingisbo in with a chance of winning this one. 29-16. He's going to be some way outside that. And Johannes Tingis is going to have to step up the pace, and he's going to have to make sure he hits the last 5 targets. Bjørn Dalen 0-1-2. That's not a winning combination. He's had many, many successes. He won the individual here in 99. With a Mr. Dixon finishing down in 55th position on that occasion, 6:41 off the pace.
Bjørn Dalen, that's a real pity. I think by trying to stay with the pace of Johannes Tingisbo, Bjørn Dalen probably coming in just a little over his comfort zone into the second prone.
Yeah, important to race your own race, particularly when it's as long as this.
Benedict Doll, that was, of course, the champion from the sprint race. He missed 3 today, 1-2-0-0. Still good shooting.
Good shooting, then that's pretty much average for him. That's what we would have expected in the sprint. We would have expected 1 or 2 misses. Now, Krasimir Anif, the Bulgarian's pretty handy with the rifle.
Well, the rifle is very, very steady, the end of the rifle. His legs will be spent after 40 minutes of racing.
Moravitz still the only man to have cleared all 20 targets.
And his teammate, Krishmar.
After the of course, Krishmar's on the way to the finish. He's not in as yet. Krishmar lying in 5th position after the 4th shoot. Absolutely right.
Anev, look at that. Take that penalty away. He would have only been 59 seconds behind.
19 out of 20 from Ada. Will that be good enough to do some business? You can see how tight it is. That one miss pushes him all the way down to 7th. And now it's Simon Ada looking to record a top 10 here on his home tracks. This is not characteristic of Ada. Oh. He had 5 down in the time it took to clear the first shot.
Isn't it strange what pressure does? Racing at home, he changed his routine massively there. Took the bronze medal in this race last year at the World Champs.
Lowell Bailey of USA on shot number 3. He's been shooting much better, and again he clears all 5. So that could be the surprise on the podium, although it's been a long time coming. And of course Tim Burke took the silver medal in Novo Mesto.
That's right,
World Championships.
He certainly did. Lowell Bailey, that is so good. And of course the employing the shooting coach, the Olympic champion in summer, 3-position shooting to bring some magic to the American team, and it's working.
Yeah, it certainly worked, and it's helped Susan Dunkley as well. She's shooting much better this season. Had a poor spell, Ruhpolding Antholz, but now looks to be back on her best form. Danny Mesetich across the line, 50.05 into the top 10. Respectable, but not sensational, which is what the Austrians are after.
Well, the oldest Austrian in the 4 racing here today, and that's probably going to be the best result. Mesetich in 9th position.
Moravitz, Fourcade, Lesser. Fourcade's run of victories in the individual has come to an end. Well, a nice slow-mo of Andrei Moravets. A lot of the winners coming from the middle of the field, slightly surprisingly, Mike.
Yeah, it's hard to say. It'll be interesting at the press conference and talking to the athletes after the race. What do they think? Where was the best part to go in this race?
And who started 51 yesterday? Gabi Kukalova of the Czech Republic. And she's got herself another silver medal from yesterday's race, finishing behind Lara Dalmeier.
And, of course, the same bib, as you're alluding to, as Moravets today. Lucky bib for the Czechs.
But is it going to be good enough? Bailey and Johannes Tingis Bø, still the two danger men out there on the course. Johannes Tingis down in fifth place after shoot number three, 36 seconds behind. Can he make that sort of time back in the closing stages? That's going to be very, very tough. Lowell Bailey, on the other hand, 12 seconds ahead of Moravets going through shoot number three.
Remember Johannes last year, for the four individual races, well, the sprint, pursuit and this race, he finished fourth. Of course, medals in the two team events.
Well, he's already got two silvers from this championship, so I'm just wondering what that's going to do to Johannes Tingis's mind for the final shoot. Do you think we're going to see one of those carefree shots, just throw caution to the wind? He wants some gold. The only way he's going to get that is to produce not only a 5 out of 5, but it's got to be the fastest shoot of the day as well.
Do you know what? I think he will just line up. He'll get his breathing under control, line up and shoot fast so that he's not changing like poor old Simon Eder did there. He changed all the routines that have been built in since he was 12. Changed them, and it doesn't always help. Stick to normal.
Power finish coming in from Michael Krizhmar. Can he get two Czechs into the top five? Shapulin's time of 48.51's going. Shapulin down a six. Krizhmar goes five. So the Czech Republic sitting 1 and 5 at the moment. And all the fans from Nové Město will be going absolutely balmy at the moment supporting this. The bars in Nové Město itself will be packed, because this is their number one sport.
It's amazing. Nine odd million people, over 1.5 million watching today's race.
36 the deficit for Bo when he came out of the range. He's cut that to 17.9. He's still flying, but he knows more than anyone else that he needs those last five targets. He will not take a medal if he misses one more. Well, that's hard truth to live with, isn't it?
It is. He knows that. The coaches know that. How is he dealing with that out there? I suppose he's just looking at, this is my process. I can fight, and I can really fight hard, and that's what he's going through right now, keeping the pace strong.
What do you think the coaches are telling him?
They'll be giving him the positives. I think that your time, yes, you're pulling back time. You're pulling back some of this one-minute deficit time that he lost on the range.
No fake news?
Sometimes coaches do that. Athletes pick up on it very quickly. Fake news, not good when you're racing.
So three misses in all for Dominic Vindish. Rungaldi remaining the only Italian medalist so far. She took the bronze medal in the women's individual yesterday. Great race from Rungaldi. Always nice to see an underdog on the podium. She was so delighted.
She was, and we saw Zingerli there in picture after the shoot. He's done so much for Italian biathlon. Great biathlete himself.
Well, as we watch Garanichev finish, just missing out on a top 10, Johannes Tingis, Mike, he's skied well on this penultimate lap already, but he's got to do the same again on the last lap to cut that margin down to an achievable one. And Moravets was not slow on that final lap.
Moravets, well, he did lose, what was it, 15 of Foucault on that last lap. You would think that Johannes is going to be faster than that.
Where's your money?
Johannes, let me think, coming in for his final shoot, difficult to tell, depends which Johannes is there, the attacking, unthinking, the composed, it's hard to say.
Well, he's got to hit five to medal. I just got the feeling on that last shot we had of him that he was skiing a little like he did on the last lap of the sprint. Slightly more rotation of the hips and the shoulders, and that's not a good sign. When he did his last lap in the pursuit, he looked immaculate, so steady.
He's having to push. That's the one possibility that he's going to come in too hard. He's having to pull that time back. So he's working like crazy on this 4 kilometres. He'll be in quite soon to shoot.
Schlesinger 94, Bjørn Dahlen started 95, Johannes Dingesbø started 96, and will be in the next 30 seconds.
First shot wide for Schlesinger.
Just bringing the rifle up onto the target.
Lovely routine. What a pity that first shot went. He kind of snatched it without thinking.
Here comes Johannes Dingesbø. This is a big moment for the Norwegians. It's a huge moment for the Czech Republic, who will be willing one of the shots to go wide. Simon Ada through 18.9. 1,100 metres to go for Ada, and he's sitting in ninth at the moment. At the finish, Austria have got Mesetic sitting in 10. He's the best of the Austrians at the moment, so Ada would dearly like to get inside that time. Here's Johannes Dingesbø. 1, 2, 3, 4. Number 5. Shot number 20 goes wide. And that costs Johannes Dingesbø a chance of his third medal.
Well, that was so fast. That was the random Johannes Dingesbø that came in there. He needed composure for that last 5.
So instead of being 16 seconds behind, he's now 1:16 behind. And if he keeps that margin, he'll be down in 7th or 8th position. Lowell Bailey, on the other hand, still has a shot at the gold medal. 12 seconds clear when he came out of the range last time. That's only dropped to 8.7. So 5 out of 5 for Bailey.
Well,
I still fancy Morawiec to win that last lap race, but a medal very, very much a possibility, because we've got 28 seconds separating first and third.
Still only 2 athletes have got the perfect score. Lowell Bailey can be the third, and he's got 8 seconds to play with, so clearly he's on form. He's got all his disciplines together.
Krishmar's gone into 5th place, incidentally, for the Czech Republic, having hit 20 out of 20. So our top 5 at the moment: Morawiec leading with 48.10. Martin Fourcade still sitting in 2nd place despite missing 2 targets. He's 17 seconds off the pace. And Eric Lesser of Germany, 28.7 in 3rd, ahead of Shemenov and Krishmar. And Anton Shapulin, who started number 1, has only been pushed down to 6th position.
Well, Ada is now the best of the Austrians. That's 9th position. Mesetic dropped down to 11th. Again, the Austrian coaches, there'll be a little bit of head shaking. What do we need to do? And with Eberhardt having missed 3 already.
Now, I know what Lowell Bailey's favourite number is going to be if he manages to hit these last 5 targets. Number 100. What a fantastic position to start from 102 starters. Eberhardt behind him has missed targets, so it's no threat. Mario Dolder of Switzerland was never going to be any threat, so he knows that if he's got the lead coming out of the range, all he has to do is to match Morawiec over the final 4 kilometres. Easier said than done. Left-handed, when did a left-handed shot last win an individual world title?
I'm going back to the 80s. Swedish guy.
17. 18 down. 19 down. 1 shot between Bailey and a medal.
Yes.
It's all the way for Lowell Bailey. 38.56. I think I heard.
Well,
the American camp, besides themselves with that shooting performance, absolutely superb. It's been coming, Mike. From 12 seconds, it's down to 6.4.
It's incredible. Lowell has had such a good season. His wife and his young child here with him all season. He's managed to get away from the team to live life a little more, and his mindset is fantastic.
Svensson almost crosses the line unnoticed. A man who's been hugely successful in the individual. He's got 8 wins at individual in the individual discipline. And that, of course, equals Ole-Einar Bjørndalen. Fourcade with 11 is the best.
And Svensson, of course, Olympic champion 2010, world champion 2008.
There you have it. The USA on top with 4 shoots completed, but a matter of 4,000 metres between Bailey and the finish. And he's looking to match that time of 48.10. Lesser is nervous. He thinks his bronze medal is going to be snatched from him right at the end of this race. And Martin Fourcade could well be pushed down into the bronze medal position. He'll go no further. So Fourcade, 17 out of 18 podiums this season.
Quite special, absolutely special. The American team, this is the best moment for the American biathlon team, Josh Thompson winning silver in this event way back in 87. And of course, Tim Burke, we mentioned earlier, taking silver in this event in 2013. They've been there or thereabouts, but this could be the best ever.
Well, Bailey being forced round the long way, that's half a second cost him. You can see how much more of the track is in the shade, so that is playing to his advantage. 6.7 his advantage coming out of the range. 42.04 the time he's trying to match from Moravitz at 17.2. We're going to get to see a lot of skiing from Bailey. Still looks comfortable, Mike. I'm impressed by the way he's flowing.
He's not panicking, you know, and that's the best way on these skating skis. As soon as you tighten up or try pressing a little harder, often it's a negative. He's absolutely composed at the moment.
Give me some idea what his legs feel like at the moment.
Oh, they will 100% be on just survival, just enough to keep balanced. And he won't want to press too much harder because that's when it all goes wrong. It's like running up, say, Ben Nevis, running up a mountain, and how you feel when you reach the top of that mountain, that's how your legs feel in the last 4Ks of a 20.
Yeah, he seems to have kept the tempo nice and high, has to lift the feet just a fraction higher than normal because of the soft snow in the sunny sections, but there is some shade out on the course, and he'll be looking to find it wherever possible. One technical corner to go, this perhaps the trickiest part of the course as he breaks to the right. 42.04, he's going to be very, very close. He had a 6 second lead coming out of the stadium, and he now has to produce an unbelievable ski. 17.2 gone. He's got another 2.8 kilometers to survive.
This is bad news for the American, losing that margin on the easier part of the course, Patrick. Now it's the hard part of the course.
Unless, of course, he decided to save something for the big climb. Looks like an injection of speed from Lowell Bailey. If he wants the gold, this is going to have to hurt more than any other ski session he's ever done.
Come on, Lowell Bailey, come on. It's survival now. This is the moment that he's waited for all of his biathlon career.
35 years old. He's been in second place before. He got a second in the sprint. I think it was Contiolati where he got a second place.
Poor old Moravitz, he's going to be watching on 2.4 seconds with what, still 3 kilometers to go. It's a nervy few minutes for Moravitz.
Well, this is what we want. This is what the fans want. It's not exactly what Moravitz wants.
there he is.
At least he's brave enough to smile. But he will be a bag of nerves at the moment. There's nothing he can do about it. He gave 100%, although he'll probably be thinking, this corner I could have got half a second. Maybe I could have been a bit quicker coming out of the shooting range. But Moravitz has just got to watch and wait. Benedikt Doll was in exactly the same position in the sprint where Johannes Tingisbo missed out by just 0.7 of a second. Johannes Tingis, Mike, I don't think he's not going to medal, is he? It's so, so tight, which is unusual for an individual.
Well, just that very last shot, the speed at which he was on the range on his last five. Yes, he's a man that takes risk, and sometimes in sport you have to take risk. But he'll be so disappointed that he missed one out of five last time.
At 18.9, will it be Bailey? Will it be Moravitz? Will it be the Czech Republic? Will it be USA?
Well, look at that last shot missed, Patrick. He's 1:12 behind at the moment, so he'd have still been chasing Moravitz. He slowed down significantly.
One bib number that everyone is waiting for, and he started six places after Michael Schlesinger. It is, of course, Bailey of the USA. Great day for the Czech Republic, and with the men's relay coming up in 2 days' time, we have to consider them as potential winners, certainly potential medalists.
Oh, look at this. This will be, well, three in the top 15, maybe. Is he going to hold on? Not quite. Well, we'll have to wait and see. Maybe top 15, three Czech Republic athletes. What a great day they've had.
Doll's time of 50.34 is bettered, but only just. Schlesinger goes 14. Doll, the gold medalist from the sprint, down into 15th place. And now just 2.5 minutes or so to wait until we see Bailey cross the line. Johannes Tingisbo started 96, so he'll be in 2 minutes earlier than the American.
Do you know, I think it was that fourth loop where he was told he had to pull time back, and I really think he put so much energy into that fourth lap, he's now spent on the fifth.
And the big question with Bailey is, was he conserving energy on the first 2 kilometres of the final loop, or was he living on the edge? He's experienced enough to know that if you work too hard over the first K, you pay a heavy, heavy price later on. Johannes Tingis, it's a good run, but one shot from a medal. That last shot, shot number 20, costing him today. He's already got two silvers, but he's a man who wants more. He wants as much as he can get. Now Bailey up towards 18.9 with 1,100 metres to go from the top of this climb. He's still got the work rate and he's still got that two-second margin.
Look,
it is a possibility.
Look how many are giving him the support running up the top of that mountain.
But he's on his last legs, Mike. No doubt about it. That 2.4 is painfully slim.
Oh, look at his shoulders, look at his head rolling left and right, his mouth wide open, trying to suck in the oxygen.
Yeah, Alexei Volkov not having too many problems staying with him. And actually, Volkov with very, very good glide at this stage. Well, he's got to stay out of the way.
But this could be good news for Lowell Bailey to tuck in behind Volkov and get some drafting down the final climb.
Yeah, that would be useful. If it gains him half a second, it might make the difference between gold and silver. A medal is a fantastic result for the Americans. Make no mistake about that, but a gold medal would change things for them.
One-tenth of a second now.
Moravitz, is he smiling? He is smiling. Oh, my goodness. Now he knows how Benedikt Doll felt at the beginning of this championships in that sprint event. I think the money is on Moravitz because he was still skiing beautifully well in the closing stages.
Do you see the smile on Moravitz? He is estimating on that section of the course, and now it's the fairly easy bit left that maybe, just maybe, he's got him.
0.1 of a second, Mike, on the start of the descent is so easy to lose.
It is. Lowell just needs to tuck in now if he can behind Volkov.
The Russian still pulling away. Lowell Bailey has given it absolutely everything today. Perfect on the range, but is it enough?
The margins are so, so minute, and if Lowell can hit this last couple of hundred metres with absolutely everything, he's still got a chance at that gold.
We're going to get our eighth nation on the podium. There's no doubt about that, because the margin between Moravitz and Martin Fourcade is 17.9, 48.10. He's got, what, some 30 seconds remaining. He's yet to come into the stadium. It's not going to happen, I don't think, for Lowell Bailey, but it will be close. Martin Fourcade watching on as well. Is he going silver or is he going bronze? Lesser knows that he's going off the podium. There's no doubt about that. In they come, still. It's the American tucked in behind Volkov of Russia, which has been useful, as Mike suggested. 48.1, 48.10, the time he's after. Bailey's recovered in the last 500 metres, and he's made it.
Whoa.
He's made it, 3.3 seconds. And Moravitz is the man who misses out. Lowell Bailey, the world individual champion. The celebrations will start, and they'll run all the way through to Sunday.
Whoa.
35 years old, and he gets his first big win. Wow. What an effort. Where did he find those 3 seconds? I think Volkov deserves a magnum of champagne, because if he hadn't been there, Bailey wouldn't be on the top of the podium.
But, you know, Lowell Bailey was a dead man skiing there. He had nothing left. Volkov just came ahead of him, and he realised, there is my one chance. It's always easier skiing in behind somebody. And now the emotions come out, because he's had one heck of a 48 minutes and 7 seconds.
Eighth in the Olympic Games in 2014, hitting 19 out of 20. He got a respectable 15th in Oslo last year, hitting 19 out of 20. Today, he's gone one better, and it's made 15 places difference. 20 hits and the gold medal. There's Max Cobb, head of sport. What a moment for him.
He's done so, so much for American biathlon. Max has given everything. And when you've got someone like Max guiding your team, you follow. You give everything that you can as well. And that's what Lowell did today.
The place to be tonight is the American House. I remember the celebrations after Tim Burke took the silver in Novo Mesto. Well, Mike, biggest upset of the day. Morovic, no real surprise. I think a lot of people were backing him to do well today. Martin Fourcade in bronze medal position, absolutely no surprise. Lyle Bailey, we saw a hint of it in the pursuit, but he faded on that last lap, missed his chance of a medal there. To come back and shoot so well in the individual. Nice to see Martin Fourcade, one of the first in to congratulate.
Well, that is so good to see. And I think the world of biathlon now respects the fact that Lowell, he's been for 18 years on the circuit, and today's his big day. Everybody respects that. And he's such a lovely guy. I do feel for Morovic, he's also a lovely guy, but 3 seconds. He just lost it on that final 900 metres.
Well, maybe if it started later. Maybe a late start was the way to go. There's certainly some decent ski times over those last laps. And actually, Mike, we talked about Volkov. The conditions on that downhill into the stadium, predominantly in the shade. It's incredible how quickly the conditions get faster when it goes from sun to shade.
Yeah, we saw that. And now the angle of the sun is so at such a tangent, it's not heating the track anymore. So the ice is just beginning to build up.
Well, cast your eye over the results. Bjørn Dalen disappointed down in the mid-40s. We've got Mickey Roesch down in 55. Scotty Dixon, 69. Only two misses, 7.10 off the pace. And you know, those two misses would have made a huge difference to him, but a much, much better result. Loganov, some people thought he was going to come and win. He's not. He's finished outside the top 70.
A lot of people thought he'd come and win, but, you know, what's going through his mind? Alex Gleave, first outing at a major championships. It's 7 penalties, a lot of pressure on his first day.
Yeah, Alex Gleave from St. Helens, just outside Liverpool.
You really deserve it. Thank you. I'm satisfied for
Well, he said, "I'm satisfied for you." That is good news from Fourcade, or a nice gesture.